Please welcome the one, the only, the famous, the fabulous, Michael Alexander.
It's been said that people have the most vivid memories between the ages of 8 and 12. Once you turn 12, you become so self-conscious that your image of yourself gets in the way of your memories. And so my story begins. 5 years ago or so, my mother, one Lila Nadine Alexander, passed away. And as often, as I'm sure you're all aware, as often happens with a death of somebody that you're particularly close to, you just enter into this phase of reflection. And it just happens. It's uncontrollable. I found myself just starting to reflect on my mother and what she had meant to me in my life and all the things we shared, the good, bad, and the indifferent. And just really what she meant to me. And as we were approaching the funeral, the service, all us kids, there's four of us, myself and three siblings, I'm the oldest, we went back to Michigan and we had cause to meet with the preacher who was going to be conducting the service at the funeral. And he wanted to get us all together to just talk about my mother, to kind of inform him a little bit about what he might say at the service, because he hadn't known her for very long. And it became apparent to me upon this meeting with the pastor that most of my memories at that point in time, most of my reflection about my mother really took me back to that 8 to 12 year old period. Whereas my three other siblings, their memories and their reflections were very recent. This may have something to do with the fact that when I turned 18 in 1967, I left Michigan to never return, except for a visit now and then. Whereas my other siblings remained and stayed in Michigan for a lot longer than I did. And then part of that reflecting back really took me back to my fifth grade year when I was 10 years old in 1959. And specifically that year to a point in early winter when my father, who was a steel worker on the south side of Detroit, was on strike. 55,000 men and women were on strike in 1959 as we were going into winter. And it was a long strike. We did not have a lot. For kids, there was a real scarcity of milk in the refrigerator. Food was there, but we had to scrape. We had to scrape by. I can remember my fifth grade teacher, Mr. Risto, coming up to me in early November, very warmly placing his hand on my shoulder and saying, "Mike, you haven't paid your book fees." And I said, as if I needed to be told. And I just looked up at him and just in a very nervous voice said, "We're on strike." And he put his hand on me very warmly and said, "That's okay." And proceeded to walk down the aisle. I can remember my father's friend, Kramer, bringing over two ducks that he had shot out duck hunting. It was the first time I was really aware that fowl came from the air and not the counter at the local butcher shop. And it was hard times, but we were getting by because of this sense of community that we had, and people understood. At about this time, my mother reads an article I don't even know the source of the article, but she reads an article about a tribe of Native Americans in northern Michigan who are really experiencing hard times. And the two things that come to mind about that were hunger and disease was happening with this probably an offshoot of the Huron tribe or the Huron Nation, which is the predominant Native American tribe in that part of the country. And my mother tells me about this article that she read. Shortly thereafter, she asked me, I think mothers have a very good way of asking, but they're really telling, to go out and collect some bottles. I know not what these bottles are going to be used for. So me and two of my friends go about collecting beer bottles. This was the time prior to growlers and designer beer. I'm talking about brown bottles with a long neck, Schlitz, fire-brewed Stroh's, Blatt's, Old Milwaukee. Beer bottles in my neighborhood were not that hard to find. There may have been a Werner's ginger ale bottle mixed in, or a Faygo red pot perhaps, but predominantly it was beer bottles on the porches, the alleyways. I can remember walking down the alley and collecting bottles. And there again, not knowing what that money is going to go for. 2 cents a pop on a bottle. Gas was 15 cents a gallon. I can remember getting a milkshake for 25 cents, plus a cent, 1 cent tax. There was a 4% sales tax in Michigan at the time. That milkshake would fill up 3 Coke glasses to the top for 25 cents. We collected enough bottles to get, I don't remember the exact amount, but it was something like $2 or $3. There again, I don't know what this money is going to be used for, but I do know one thing. We need milk. And I, the collector of the bottles, needs a new hockey stick. It's November. The ponds are about to freeze, and I am a hockey player. I am a pretty good skater. Hans Brinker has nothing on me. My stick is in dire need. I need a new stick. Anybody that's ever played hockey as a child knows that your best friend is electrician's tape. The thing was held together by tape. It was kind of pointed. The wood had been kind of worn down. I've got a new stick already picked out. I'm thinking hockey stick. If not hockey stick, then at least some milk for my baby brother. So we go out and collect the bottles, bring the money back to my mother, and she takes the money and proceeds to put it in an envelope to send away to this Native American tribe in northern Michigan. There goes my hockey stick. There goes the milk. But what remained is what she said. No matter how little you have, you can always pass some along.